Hello everyone, welcome back to JEE Aspire. My name is Shimon Joseph and I'm a math master teacher at Vedantu. So guys, based on your popular request, I've decided to take up the topic permutation and combination today. I've got some really interesting questions to discuss with unique approaches. I hope all of you can benefit from it. Okay guys, so let us dive right in without wasting much time. So the first question that I have brought for you is right over here. I hope all of you can see that. If there is any issue, I'll read it out. So here, they are given in the xy plane, how many straight lines whose x-intercept is a prime number and whose y-intercept is a positive integer pass through the point 4, 3? This is the question which is asked. They're asking how many straight lines are possible in such a manner. Okay guys, so this is not directly PNC. It has something to do with coordinate geometry and properties of numbers as well. Okay, so for starting off, this is an easy question. Let us try to see how to solve it. So if you want to try it out on your own, now is the right time to pause it. You can try it out and then maybe later join us in the discussion. Okay guys, so let us discuss this answer. And if you guys know the answer, comment it down in the chat box. I'll be looking at it. So now I want to solve this question. So first look at what they have given guys. They have said x intercept and they have said y intercept. So looking at the intercepts, I am convinced to go with the intercept form of straight line equation because it's a xy plane and they're asking straight line. I'm very comfortable with that. I know various forms of straight lines. I know the normal form, parametric form, intercept form, and so many other forms, right? So here for this, intercept form would be apt. So I switch to that. Okay. So let us write it down. So let's say my x-intercept is A and my y-intercept is B. So my equation of line would be x by A plus y by B equal to 1. I hope all of you got that. That is pretty simple. All of us know that, is it not? Now, they are saying that this line passes through 4, 3 is one condition. So let me substitute that. If 4, 3 lies on this line, it has to satisfy it. So 4 by A plus 3 by B is equal to 1. So now what do? I get B in terms of A. Let me do that. So if I get B in terms of A, what do I get? 3 by B is equal to A minus 4 by A, which implies B is equal to 3A by A minus 4. Is it not? Normal simplification, cross multiply, collect terms, keep it to the left hand side and then solve for B. Something like that. Now, I will explain it to you in a while why I am doing all this. Is that clear? I will explain it to you in a while. Now, I hope all of you have got it up to this step. I am moving on to the next step. What will I do in the next step? I want to make sure I bring in some constant so that I can play around with the property of A. What is the property of A? A is a prime number, guys. Okay, A is a prime number. So here, I can't do anything because my numerator also has A and my denominator also has A. So there's nothing concrete that I can come up with. So what I do here is I will subtract 12 and I will add 12. So when I subtract and add 12, you will observe what is going to happen right now. So my B will become what? My B will become 3 plus 12 by A minus 4. Now the beauty of what I did here is nothing but I got rid of the A which is in the numerator. I brought in a constant plus a constant in the numerator, which is brilliant guys. I'll tell you why. Now I can play with A because A is a prime number. If A is a prime number, what are the values it can take? So it can take values like 2, 3, 5, 7 and so on. Okay. So now when A is 2 or when A is 3, my B will be negative. But wait a minute, what is given in the question? My B is also a positive integer, is it not? So my B cannot be negative. So 2 and 3 are ruled out because when A is 2, think about it, it will be minus 6. 3 minus 6 will be minus 3. So that is a negative number. And similarly, when A is 3, this will be 3 minus 12, which will be minus 9, even worse. So that is also not allowed. So what are the possible values of B? For the possible positive values of B, my A has to be either 5, 7 or the next prime numbers 11 and so on. But B has to be a positive integer, right? So if b has to be an integer, then a minus 4 has to divide 12. Brilliant, right? It's a good question, guys. So a minus 4 must divide 12. So if a minus 4 has to divide 12, let me say, if a is 5, does 5 minus 4 divide 12? Yes, that is true. So a can be 5, that's a valid value. Now let's say a is equal to 7. So 7 minus 4, 3, does it divide 12? Yes, 3 divides 12, I know that. So 7 is also a valid value. Now whatever comes later on, let's say 11 or 13. Now 11 minus 4 does not divide 12. So that is wrong. And 13 minus 4 again does not divide 12. That is also wrong. And whatever comes later is greater than 12, because 17 minus 4, 17 is the next prime number. 17 minus 4 will be 13, and 12 by 13 does not make sense, right? Because we are looking at integers, is it not? So for that reason, I stopped there. So there are only two possible values of A. So how many lines are possible? The total number of lines possible are going to be? Why, sir? You just found out A, you didn't find B. Guys, B is fixed based on the value of A. So if I put a value of A, I get a corresponding value of B. If I put another corresponding value of A, I get one more B. That's it. So there are two such pairs. That's it. Clear? So the answer for this question would be two lines. I hope all of you have got it. I'll move away for a while. You guys can copy it down. And if you have any doubts in this question, please comment it down. I will get back to you. Perfect, guys. Good. So let's move on to the next question. So let's check the answer. The answer is 2. I hope all of you have got that. Now, moving on to the next question. So I'll read it out for all of you. So here, if all the triangles which are, all the rectangles which are not squares are formed on a chessboard, how many different values of area of these triangles will be possible if the sides are all odd numbers? So guys, you have to pay attention to this question a lot, because very, very high chance of going wrong here. It is not a tough question. The reason I picked this is because of the mistakes you can make in this. Okay, so let us observe that one by one. So for this, I need you to try it out for 30 seconds at least. Okay, only then you will realize the mistakes you can commit here. So the first thing which I want all of you to notice, if you want to try it, pause it right now. See, it is a rectangle whose sides are all odd numbers. And another thing to keep in mind is, they said rectangles which are not squares. Okay, so that should be kept in mind while solving. And then they are not worrying about the sides or number of rectangles which are possible. Rather, they are worried about the areas of these rectangles. Okay, so ultimately my outcome that is needed, or the different outcomes that I am looking at, is just the different values of areas. So if I get a different value of area, that is counted in my solution. As simple as that. Okay guys, so let us try to solve this question. I will get started with a diagram, of course. Okay, so let us see, you have a chessboard. So you have, I hope that's 8 divisions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah. So this is how a chessboard looks like. You have 8 divisions, 8 cross 8. Now, I want to find a rectangle. Now, the sides are going to be odd numbers. So I can have 1, or I can have 3, or I can have 5, or I can have 7 as the side lengths. So this is very crucial. So this question has got nothing to do with the chessboard, unlike usual questions on PNC. So usual questions on PNC, what do they say? They'll ask you to the movement of queen, or movement of the one of the players. In such a way they ask questions, or they might ask you different rectangles or count the number of rectangles and so on. But here, this question has got not much to do with the actual chessboard. Okay guys, so only limitation is obtained from the chessboard. So here you have 1, 3, 5, 7 as a side lengths. So now this 1357 is going to be the same in the other dimension as well, is it not? So if I take this as length, my breadth is also going to be 1357. Got it? So what are the various possibilities? I have 1357 and then I have 1357. So now I have four options for my one dimension and four options for my other dimension. So totally how many rectangles are possible? So totally one might think answer is 4×4. But guys, wait a minute. When I did this, I am counting all the possibilities of this interacting with this. So when I make this 1357 combined with again 1357, there is a possibility that 1 and 1 is paired, 3 and 3 is paired, 5 and 5 is paired, 7 and 7 is also paired. So these pairs which are identical are going to lead to a square. And in the question, it is clearly specified that you are looking at rectangles which are not squares. So what do? I subtract 4. Now, many of you might be, you know, convinced that 12 is the answer. But you have to be very cautious here, guys. What are they asking in the question? They are asking different values of areas. So if you look at it carefully, 1 and 3, the area is 1 into 3. 3 and 1, the area is again 3, right? So, there are two pairs which give the same area because multiplication is commutative, right? So, because of that reason, you have to divide your answer by, and that will give you the value of the right answer. Clear? So, why am I dividing by 2? The reason I'm dividing by 2 is because there are cases wherein my area comes out to be same. For example, 1 into 3. 3 into 1 is going to give me the same area, and then 3 into 5, 5 into 3 is also going to give me the same area because of commutative nature of multiplication. So I need to remove those cases which are repeated twice, because ultimately I am looking at only area value. I just want a distinct area value. So 3 into 5, 5 into 3 are not two different cases. They are two different rectangles. That's fine. Their length and breadth are different. But what is the area? Area is same, right? I am looking at area. So that is what is going to matter to me ultimately. Is that clear to everyone? So I hope all of you have got it. Perfect. So with that, let us move forward to the next question. So the answer for this one is 6. I hope all of you have got it. If you have any doubts, please do comment it, guys. Let's have a interactive session. I'll be part of the chat with you guys. I'll help you out. You can let me know what is the doubt. Now, this is a typical Bayes theorem question. Should be solvable by all of you. I'll just move away for a while. You guys can try it out. I'll read the question first. So here we have a player A tossing a fair coin. So if the fair coin shows a tail, so this guy will roll a fair die. And A score, this guy's score is counted based on the number the die shows. Okay. This is when you toss a coin and tail falls. Next, if you toss a coin and if you get a head, you will again toss the coin 5 more times. So my score will be the number of heads shown in this case. So when I count the number of heads, I also include the first toss wherein I get a head. Is that clear? So now they are asking you to find the probability that A rolled a die given that his score is 3. So typical Bayes theorem, right? So something is given to you, you need to find out through this way it came. Got it? So first, what do I do? So if you want to try it out, pause the video. I'm going to discuss or give you a hint. Maybe after that you guys can try it. So first, what I do is whenever a Bayes theorem question is asked or whenever a question on conditional properties asked, always get the total probability, guys. So now, what is the total probability that I'll be looking for or trying to get? I'll try to get the total probability of A getting a score of 3. So what do you mean by that? I want to understand what are all the ways in which A can get a score of 3, and I will calculate the probability of that. Got it? So let me do that first and show it to you. So here, Let's see the probability of A getting a score of 3. How can that occur? That can occur when I first drop a tail. So I toss a coin, a tail falls, and then A score is what? A score is the number that the die shows. So if I drop a tail, if I get a 3, then my score becomes 3. Is that clear? So that is how it works. Got it? Perfect, guys. So now, one way to get a score of 3 is to toss, drop a tail, throw a die, get a 3 out of it. So now, I have to find the probability of throwing a coin, getting a tail, and throwing a die, and getting a 3. Got it? So these are all combined together to give me the probability of the first method. That will be how much? 1 by 2 for getting a tail. Got it? After getting a tail, I need to roll a 3 in the die. Because my score is 3, right? I'm looking at that. So if I want to get a score of 3, I need to roll a 3 in the die. So if I want to roll 3, how many chances are there? How many ways can I roll a 3? There's only one way. And what are the total outcome? 6. So the answer is 1 by 2 into 1 by 6. For the first method of getting a score of 3. What is the other method in which I can get a 3? The other method is, instead of throwing a tail first, I will throw a head. So if I throw a head, what will happen? If I throw a head, no more dice. Dice is forgotten. Got it? So now, after I throw a head, I have to throw 5 more coins. And my score is the total number of heads, including the first head. So I throw a head, that is counted, one head. So my score is 1 by default. After this, 5 times I throw coins. But I want to end up with a score of 3. Why? I am looking at total probability of 3 here. Got it? So, first head, I got a 1. After that, 5 times I am throwing the coin. In the 5 times I am throwing a coin, I should get just 2 heads exactly. In the 5 times I am throwing a coin, I should get just 2 heads exactly. Because 2 plus 1 already will give me 3. Got it? So, that is how it works. Now, guys, this is case 1. Method 1 of getting a score of 3. Method 2 is what I'm going to write. How are they linked? It can be either method 1 or method 2. So when I say either or, I always add. That is coming from fundamental principle of counting, is it not? So when I say or, I add, and when I say and, I multiply. So this is method 1 or method 2. So or will give you a plus there. Method 2 is what? Method 2 is throwing a head first. So throwing a head will be 1 by 2. After I throw a head, I throw the coin 5 times. So it is Bernoulli's trials now. Clear? So after I throw this head 1 by 2, I am going to go to Bernoulli's trials. Out of 5 times, I need exactly 2 to be head. So out of 5, I choose 2 places. And in those 2 places, I want head. And in the other 3 places, I don't want head because exactly 2 heads I want, right? So it is going to be into 1 by 2, that is tails in the other 3 places. Did you all understand? 1 by 2 for throwing a head, that is the first case. After I throw a head, I will toss the 5 more coins. If I toss 5 more coins and I want a score of 3, I need to get 2 heads in those 5 tosses. So 5c2, because out of 5, any 2 coins I choose, in those 2 coins, I want head. So 1 by 2 whole square. And in the rest, I want tails, because exactly 2. Got it? So for that reason, 1 by 2 whole cube. That's it, done. What I've written here is the total probability of getting a score of 3. Clear, guys? Now, given that I got a score of 3, what is the probability that it came from rolling a die? Rolling a die means what? It came from method 1. So now I hope all of you realize the importance of writing total probability. Because once I write total probability, I just need to pick that term, take it to the numerator, divide by the entire thing. That's it. So I'll take it to the numerator. And then I will divide by the entire thing. Plus, what do we have here? 1 by 2, 1 by 2 to the power 5, 1 by 2 to the power 6 will become into 5c2, I think that is 10, right? 5c2 is 10. So, let's simplify it quickly. Looks like a big calculation. Okay, so 1 by 12 divided by 1 by 12 plus 5 by 2 to the power 5, 5 by 32. So I think the LCM will be 192. 192 is how much? 16 times 16 by 12 divided by 16 by 192 by 16 by 192 plus 32 6 are right. So 30. So 30 by 192. So 192, 192, 192 will get cancelled. What do you have? You have 16 by 46, which is 8 by 23. And do we have 8 by 23 in the option? Yes, of course. So the right answer for this question would be 8 by 23. I hope all of you have got it. So if you have any doubt, you can let me know in the chat, guys. I will help you out. It's a pretty interesting question, right? So looks very simple, typical Bayes' theorem kind of question, but lots of good interpretations here. So you have to understand what is total probability and why total probability is important, how it makes it easier for you to solve questions on Bayes' theorem. So I hope all of you have got it. Any issues, do let me know in the chat. Okay, so let's move forward to the next question. But before that, let's verify this answer. Yes, that's absolutely right. 8 by 23 is the correct answer. I hope all of you who tried on your own have also got the correct ones. Okay, if not, please check out the recording. Now, moving on to the next question. This is a very good question. Okay, so this is pretty interesting. I would like if all of you try it out on your own. So I'll read it out for you guys first. So in how many different ways can a sum of 20 rupees be paid in 1 rupee coins, 50 paisa coins and 25 paisa coins if each variety of coins is available in unlimited number? Okay, so you have all the resources. You have 1 rupee, 50 paisa and 25 paisa coins. Now you have to pay 20 rupees to someone, let's say. In how many different ways can you do that? You can have 10 1 rupee coins and then some other combination of 50 paisa and then some other combination of 25 paisa. Like that, you can come up with so many ways, right? So what is the total number of ways of giving this 20 rupees to that person? That is the question. You should think about it and solve it. Clear? So I will get started. Now, if you want to try it, pause it and then come back to the solution. Okay, guys? Perfect. So let's look at this question. So here, I have to pay 20 rupees in 50 paisa, 25 paisa and 1 rupee. So guys, let us say the number of 1 rupee coins is X. This is the number of 1 rupee coins. And let's say the number of 50 paisa coins, right? Here is where the beauty of this question is. So 50 paisa coin is the main player in this question. Why do I say that? We will have a look at it right now. So 50 paisa coin can either be even or odd. I can have odd number of 50 paisa coins or I can have even number of 50 paisa coins, is it not? So let us say first case, I am taking even number of 50 paisa coins. So let's say the number of 50 paisa coins is 2y. So what am I assuming? This is case 1. When 50 paisa is even. Got it? This is the master stroke of this question, guys. You have to split it in two cases so that it makes your calculation much easier, which you will all see in a while. Okay, so 2 into y is the number of 50 paisa coins. But guys, when I look at the monetary value of it, x 1 rupee coins will give me monetary value as x only, because x into 1 will be x. But the moment I go to 50 paisa, 2y 50 paisa coins are there. So the monetary value will be into 1 by 2. Why into 1 by 2? Because 50 paisa, right? 50 paisa is half a rupee. Got it? So for that reason, I write it this way. Now, what do you think will be the number of 25 paisa coins? See, the total amount you are paying is 20, right? You have x, an integer number of 1 rupee coins, which will be an integer. 2y times of 50 paisa coins, which will again be an integer. So whatever I get from 25 paisa coins should also be an integer. So 25 paisa coins should be a multiple of 4. Is it not? Think about it, guys. If I want to complete it, make it a whole integer sort of, that is 20 rupees, I need to have multiple of 4 times of 25 paisa coins. Is it not?
So for that reason, I will take the number of 25 pice coins to be 4z.
Got it?
And what is the monetary value of 25 pice coin? It is 1 by 4. Now that should be equal to 20.
So what do you get from here?
I get x plus y plus z equal to 20.
Well, x, y, z are all non-negative integers. They can be zero also. I need not have 1 rupee coins at all. Did they say at least 1 rupee? No. Did they say at least 150 pice? No. Did they say at least 125 pice coin? No. Therefore, I can take it to be non-negative integers. That means they can take values from 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So this is a direct application of Beggar's formula. So what is Beggar and coin formula? It is going to be n plus r minus 1 c r minus 1. So what is n? N is this. What is r? R is the number of terms here. Number of variables on the left hand side. So n plus r minus 1 c r minus 1. I hope that is clear to everyone. So this will result in how much? This is going to be equal to 22 c2, which is equal to 21 into 11, which is equal to 231. Now, wait a minute, we got 231 and in the options also we have a 231. So, should I mark it? Of course not. Because, what is this? It is case 1. We just solved one case. We have still halfway to go. Got it? So, I hope all of you have understood this. I'm going to erase this. So, I want you guys to take it down, digest this and then let me know what doubts you have in the chat. I will help you out. Okay? So please take it down, guys. I'll give you probably a 10 second pause so that all of you can copy it down or take a screenshot of it, which will be better, I feel. Okay, so let's go ahead and see what is the next case. So, let me just keep this number alone because it is important to get the answer. So the number is 231 from first case. Okay. So now second case, 50 pice is going to be odd. Okay. So 50 pice is odd means what? So I have x 1 rupee, same thing. 1 rupee doesn't matter. So it's going to be x into 1 plus 50 pice is odd. So 2y plus 1 into 1 by 2, 50 pice. So now I have x into 1 rupee plus odd times of 50 pice. So it will result in something like 17.50 or let's say something like 9.50 because this will give you a whole number. This will give you a whole number, but this will give you something multiple of 50 pice, odd multiple of 50 pice. So when I add them both together, it will result in something like 7.50, 8.50, 9.50, 10.50 and so on. What I'm trying to say is it will never be a whole number. Got it? Because I'm multiplying odd multiples of 50 pice. So now, effectively what do I want to produce? I want to produce 20 rupees. So effectively whatever comes out is a whole number. So if I want to produce a whole number in the end, now I can play with 25 pice coin. So can anyone comment what will the number of 25 pice coins be? Can anyone comment or let me know what will be the number of 25 pice coins? B. I'm sure many of you would have got it right. So let us go ahead and solve this. The 25 pi coins will be 4z plus 2. This will be the number of 25 pi coins into 1 by 4 is equal to 20. And why did I multiply by 1 by 2 and 1 by 4? Because I'm getting the monetary value. What is on the right hand side? On the right hand side, I have 20 rupees, right? That's a value. That's money. So I have to make sure my left hand side expression also gives me money. Clear? So that is exactly what I'm doing. Now coming to the point, why 4z plus 2? So plus 2 is coming just to negate this plus 1 of 50 pice. So plus 2 into 1 by 4 will give you 50 pice. So it makes the gap left by 50 pice, it closes it and becomes a whole number. And why 4z? Because 25 pice coin, just like the previous case, it has to be a multiple of 4 so that effectively it's an integer. Why effectively it should be an integer? Because look at the right hand side. I am trying to produce 20 rupees, right? So for that reason, it goes that way. I hope all of you have got it. Now it's a simple solution from here. Okay. Very similar to what we did in the previous question. Only thing, previous case. Only thing is, you'll have some terms here which has to be taken to the other side. So let me open it and show it for you. So it's going to be x plus y plus 1 by 2 plus z plus 1 by 2 is equal to 20. So it is going to be x plus y plus z is equal to 19. That's the only difference over here. Clear? So x plus y plus z equal to 19. Again, I'm looking at the number of non-negative integer solutions for this. Again, an application of Beggar's formula. Is it not? Because x can be 0, y can be 0, z can be 0. They can start from 0 and go upwards. Clear? So, now, what is the number of non-negative solutions for this? N plus r minus 1, c r minus 1, which is equal to 21c2, which is equal to how much? 20 into 21 by 2. Is it not? It's 20 into 21 by 2, which will be 210 by 205, I guess. Is that so? So, let us just check it. So, it will be 21 into 20 by 2, which will be 210. I'm sorry. Yeah. So, 210 plus 231 will be 441. That will be the answer for my question. Clear? Good one. I hope all of you liked it. There's something new which you learned here. Splitting into cases and solving. Such questions are quite frequent and requires a little bit of thinking, guys. You just need to break it into cases and solve so that you can make your calculation easier. So this was not difficult, right? Calculating x plus y plus z equal to 20, getting 231, and then calculating x plus y plus z equal to 19, getting 210 was not difficult. It doesn't take much time. So if the same question was asked in an exam, we could have solved it in less than 2 minutes. I'm sure all of you would agree with that, right? So here, why did I add both of this? Again, go back to your fundamental principle of counting. What did I say? Case 1 or case 2. It can occur through case 1 or case 2. So when I combine them, I add them. Clear? It is not case 1 and case 2. That does not make sense. So I hope all of you have got it. Let's move forward. I'm going to erase it. If you want to take a screenshot, now is the right time. I'm moving away from the screen so that you need not have me blocking the view. Okay, so let's see what is the answer. It's 441, that's right. So let's go to the next question, which is right over here. So this is a comprehension. So they have mixed badminton with tennis. I don't know why they did that, because it's supposed to be in Sanya, right? So they put Saina. Saina Nehwal is a badminton player. Okay, let's not worry about that too much. So here, Saina is to play with Sharapova in a 3-set match. Okay, so tennis, women's tennis is 3-set. You win 2, you have directly solved it. In the sense, like, if you win the first 2 sets, the match is over, because it's 3-set. Got it? So that you should be knowing for this question. That's the reason I'm saying. For a particular set, the probability of Saina winning the set is Y. And if she wins, then the probability of her winning the next set becomes root Y. So if she wins the first set, then the second set probability of winning will become root y. If the probability of winning the first set is y, got it? Else, the probability that she wins the next one becomes y square. Got it? So if she lost the first one, then the second one, her probability will become y square. Got it? I hope all of you are clear with that. So there is no possibility that a set is to be abandoned. So no way a set will be abandoned or drawn or something like that. Clear? So R is the probability that Saina wins the first set. So R is the probability that Saina wins the first set if R is equal to 1 by 2. So what do you mean by that? So 1 by 2 is the probability of Saina winning the first set. Then the probability that the match will end in first 2 sets is nearly equal to how much? Guys, it might look like a very, very simple question, but you have to put a little bit of thought into it. Clear? It's not tough. It's an easy question. The only thing is, you have to understand what is meant by match ending in first 2 sets. Clear? So you can try it out. I'll give you probably 10-15 seconds and then we will get started with the solution part of this question. Okay? So I'll move away so that you can see the question clearly. Make a note of it. Try it. Pause the video and then come back. Clear? Good. So now let's see what is happening over here. So what is meant by the maths getting over in the first two sets? So many of you will predict this one. Maths getting over in the first two sets means Saina will win the first set and Saina will win the second set, sir. Pakka. That is correct.
Okay. So let me write it down. So Saina wins first set and Saina wins the second set. That is absolutely true.
Got it. And listen very carefully, pay attention to AND or OR. Saina winning first and Saina winning second. This is one possibility. Or,
so when I say OR, I put plus.
So what is the other possibility? So many times people will be tending to go in the direction of Saina only again. But guys, you have to end the match at two set. So don't take Saina losing first and then Saina winning second. Saina losing first and Saina winning second doesn't matter to me because the match will not get over at two sets. Because if Saina loses first and wins the second, then there is a third set that is going to happen, right? The decider. That I don't want. I am looking at match getting over at two sets. So the second possibility is Saina losing first and Saina losing second. That is the second possibility. That is the only catch in this question. Okay. After that, pretty simple. So what is the probability of Saina winning the first one? That is 1 by 2. Is it not? 1 by 2. So if Saina wins the first one, if Saina wins, then the probability of winning the second match becomes root y. So here it was 1 by 2, right? Here it was 1 by 2. The probability that she won the first set. So the probability of winning the second set will become 1 by root 2. That is how it goes. So this is the first part plus now the second part, second method of arriving at the result. Saina losing the first one. So Saina loses the first one in how many ways? What is the probability of that? That probability is again going to be 1 by 2 because she has a 1 by 2 probability of winning the first set and 1 by 2 of losing the first set, obviously, right? So 1 by 2 is the losing probability and Saina losing the second as well. Now, if Saina loses the first one, then probability that she will win the next one becomes y square. So probability that Saina loses first, 1 by 2, and probability that Saina loses the second. But we don't have probability that Saina loses, right? We have probability that Saina wins. So probability that Saina wins will become y square. What is y? Y is 1 by 2. So it will become 1 by 4. And that is the probability of Saina winning. But what do I want here? I want bar. Bar is nothing but losing. Because I want the match to end at two sets. Got it? So what is the probability of her losing? It'll be 1 minus 1 by 4. That's it. Clear? So it's going to be 1 minus 1 by 4, which will be 3 by 4. And then the value you guys can calculate. So what will this be? This will be around 1 by root 2 is 0.7. 0.7 by 2 is 0.35, let's say. Plus, that will be 3 by 4 into 1 by 2. What is 0.75? This will be 0.375. So when I add both of them, what do I get? 0.725. Something around that. So the answer will be option A. Okay. I hope all of you have got it. Simple question. Little bit of catch because of the wording. I hope all of you have got it. Is it not? So if you have doubts in this, do post it. I will help you out. Shouldn't be difficult. So you guys can note it down. Let's move forward to the next question. So next question is also based on the same comprehension. Let us have a look at it. So this answer is 0.73, which is absolutely right. Now, if R is equal to 1 by 2 and Saina wins the second set, then the probability that she has won the first set as well. So this is coming from Bayes theorem because conditional, right? So I'm asking Saina won the second set. Then what is the probability of her winning the first set as well? So again, guys, go back to your total probability. Total probability is very useful in handling Bayes theorem questions. We just saw in today's class, right? The first or the second question. So when we did that, I wrote the total probability down and that made my solution very fast for Bayes theorem. So let me do the same over here. So if you want to try it out, I'll move away. Look at the question, solve it for a while and then we will discuss, okay?
So let me go to the solution part of it now.
Perfect. So here, Saina wins the second set. So that is the condition. So what is the probability of Saina winning the second set? So Saina wins the first one, wins the second one. So what will be that? Winning the first one, the probability is 1 by 2. Is it not? Because R is probability of Saina winning the first set. So that is 1 by 2. So Saina wins first one and Saina wins second one. Saina winning second one should be there for sure. Why? Because that is what I am finding the total probability for, right? Saina winning the second set. So second set, her probability of winning will be 1 by root 2, just like what we saw in the previous question. Why? Because she won first and she won the next also. So then her probability becomes root of y. So root of 1 by 2 is root of 2. Got it? So that's what I wrote here. Now, this is one method. Winning the first one, winning the second one. What is the other way in this, in which this can happen? The other way in this, in which this can happen is going to be losing the first and winning the second. Isn't that right? Saina loses the first and wins the second. Because here, I'm not looking at the match ending, guys. I'm just looking at what ways can Saina win the second, given that she has won the first as well. Go, okay. So my whole focus is on Saina winning the second set. So Saina won the second set here. This is one possibility. The other possibility is Saina losing the first one, which is again going to be 1 by 2 because winning is 1 by 2. Losing also will be 1 by 2 only, right? Okay. Now, after she loses, she is winning the next one. So after she loses, she is winning the second one. What will happen there? So if she loses, then her probability will become y square. Her probability of winning the next one becomes y square. So 1 by 2 will become 1 by 4. And why do I leave it as 1 by 4? Because I want her to win. I want her to win the second set. So second set, it becomes y square, which is 1 by 2 whole square. And that will be the probability of winning. So what are the two cases? This is winning, winning. This is losing, winning. That's it. There's no other case, right? There's no other possibility. So I wrote my total probability. Now, what is the conditional? What is the base theorem they're asking? They're asking, what is the probability she won the first set as well? This can be very easily done. So first set as well is this one. So this will be in my numerator. And my denominator will be all the others. That will be 1 by 8. That's it. So multiply by 8, what do you get? You will get root 2, 2 root 2 by 2 root 2 plus 1. So what will that value be? 2 root 2 is nothing but 2.828 divided by 2.828 plus 1, 3.828. So it should be around 0.7 again. And there's only one option around 0.7, which is option A. Got it? Not a very difficult question. I'm sure some of you would have found it very, very, very simple. But still, good application of total probability. I hope some of you benefited from learning this question. Okay. So let's move forward, guys. If you have any doubts, again, do let me know in the comments or in the chat. So the answer for this one is 0.74. Now, coming to circular permutation. But is this circular permutation? Think about it and then solve it, okay? So suppose n people are seated around a round table, and from those n, I'm selecting 3 people at random. And Pn is the probability that at least 2 of them are sitting next to each other. Then P7 is equal to A by B, where A by B is expressed in the lowest term. Now I want you to find what is A plus B. It's a numerical question. Okay, so let me explain the question to some of you. If you don't want to hear the explanation, you can pause it. You can work it out on your own. And maybe before I start solving, you should come up with the answer. Okay, so let us discuss the method of understanding this question. So there are n people who are seated around a round table, guys. Out of those n, I select 3 people. Okay, now when I select those 3 people, I want to make sure that at least 2 of them are together. In how many ways can I do that? That is exactly what they're asking. Clear? So try it out and then come back and join me in the solution. So let's solve this. So first, in this question, you can either solve by variable n or you can directly take 7, whichever suits for you. Because 7 is given, I will always prefer going with 7 because it's a small number and it makes my calculation much easier. Clear? So you can go by either way, both are fine, guys. Clear? So let us go with 7. It's easier to do that way. So let's say you have a round table. There are 7 people. Let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So now, you want to select 3 people. So what is the probability of this? So probability of this event A, wherein at least 2 of them are sitting next to each other. Okay, so that is my probability A. Event A is 2 of them, at least 2 of them sitting next to each other. So that is equal to number of ways divided by sample space. Now my sample space will be NC3. I hope all of you have got that. Because out of n people, I choose 3 at random. So it's going to be NC3. So here, n is 7, right? So I can erase n and write it as 7C3. Got it? So base is going to be, the denominator is going to be 7C3. Now let's work on the numerator, which is the important part in this question. Okay? So first, I'm going to split it into cases. What are the two cases? The two cases are, first one is all 3 together. All 3 together. Because at least 2 together means what? At least 2 should be together or 3 of them should be together. Got it? So for that reason, I take this as my first case because it's easier to solve. Now, how many ways can 3 people be together in a round table? You can very easily calculate, guys. It's going to be 1 and then 2 and then 3 and then you have 4 and then you have 5 and then you have 6 and then you have 7. So totally 7 ways, because after that you'll start repeating. Is it not? That's it. Write 7 over here. Plus, that is case 1 or case 2. What is case 2? Case 2 is exactly 2 together and 1 separate. Okay, exactly 2 together and 1 separate. So I need the diagram again, so I'm going to erase it. If you want to understand this, take a screenshot right now. Okay, so I'm going to erase this diagram and draw the second case here. Okay, so let's draw the circle again. You have a round table, you have 7 people, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, you want 2 of them to be together and the other one should be away from them. So how do I select this? So how can I select 2 people, guys? Let me select two people first and then I'll worry about the other guy. Okay, in how many ways can I select 2 people? Again, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's it. After that, it repeats. So again, I have 7 ways of selecting 2 people. But wait a minute, it's not done. After I select 2 people, selecting 2 people and 1 from the rest in such a way that he is not together with them. So if I select these 2, I cannot select these 2. So how many options I have? I have 3 options, is it not? I have 3 options. That's it, done. So if I select these 2, I cannot select these 2 because if I select these 2, then they'll become 3 together, which is counted in the previous case. So I need to select one guy from these 3. So in these 3, how will I select one guy? 3C1. 3C1 is nothing but 3. Got it? Done. Was it difficult? That's the answer. So the answer is going to be what? 28 by 35, which is 4 by 5. So if it is 4 by 5, then what is A plus B? A plus B is 9. So 9 will be my answer for this question. I hope all of you have got it. So when you write it in N, let me write down the expression for you. So if you write in terms of N instead of 7, the answer would be N plus N into N minus 4 divided by NC3. So this will be the expression when you write it in terms of N. Very easily relatable. You guys can try it out. If you have any confusion in getting this, you can comment down below. I will help you. So guys, if that is clear, we will move forward. We have one more question to go. Another interesting one. But before that, let us check the answer. I hope all of you can see that. It's almost cropped out. The answer is 9. Okay, so no worries. Now, I want you to find the maximum value of p such that 3 to the power p divides this. Okay, so this is not a direct application of p and c. It's supposed to be in binomial. But anyway, we'll discuss it. So here, how do we solve this? Please try it out. And again, it's a numerical. It's a single digit numerical. You guys can let me know your answers in the comment. Someone must answer it, right? Okay, so let's get started. I'll solve it. So I want to find out the maximum value of p such that 3 to the power p divides my given expression over here. Okay. So first, this is not in a favorable form. So usually whenever exponent is asked of a prime number that 2, I know a formula, right? We know this formula. So exponent of a prime p in n factorial is equal to how much? N by p plus n by p square, gif of that, plus n by p cube, and so on, is it not? So what is this? This is nothing but n by p greatest integer function plus n by p square greatest integer function, and so on. So this is the only formula that I know. But what they have given here doesn't look like this. So how do I go about solving this? That is the main catch of this question. So let us see how to simplify this. Okay. So guys, this is an important formula. If you do not know this, please take it down. You can try it out. Very common in standard textbooks. Any textbook you take, they'll have questions based on this. In binomial theorem. Okay. So let's erase this and go to the solution part of this question. So guys, I'm starting to solve. If you want to try it out on your own, you can pause the video to avoid distractions. Okay. So first, what do? I multiply and divide by 50 factorial. And then what is left out? 51. All the odd numbers multiplication is there. Till 97 into 99. So what I do is to complete this as 100 factorial. So 50 I have. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 till 50. 51 I have. What is missing? 52 is missing. So what do? I multiply 52, divide by 52. I multiply 54, divide by 54. I multiply 98, divide by 98. I multiply 100 and I divide by 100. So what does that leave me with? So this numerator is going to become 100 factorial. So my numerator will become 100 factorial divided by 50 factorial is already there in my denominator. Apart from that, what do I have? Apart from that, I have 52, 54 till all the even numbers, right? From 52 up to 100. So what I do is I can take 2 common from here, 2 common from here. How many 2's can I take common? This is 1, 2, how many terms are there? Can anyone guess? Is it 50 terms? Guys, it's not 50 terms, it's 25 terms. Because from 50 to 100, there are 50 terms. But I'm counting only even numbers, right? So there are 25 terms. So if I take 2 to the powers common, I will get 2 to the power 25. And that leaves me with 26. Because if I take 2 common, it'll be 26. If I take 2 common, it'll be 27. Next will be 28 up to 49 into 50. So now, again I notice a pattern. So if I multiply and divide by 25 factorial, this will complete 50 factorial. So the entire expression in the question reduces to this. That's it, done. That is my entire expression. Now, can I use the formula which I taught you? Absolutely, yes. I can use it for 100 factorial separately. I can use it for 25 factorial separately. I can use it for 50 factorial separately. And when I solve it separately, I will get the exponent directly. Okay. So guys, I hope all of you have got it. Probably you can make a note of this. Take a screenshot and then go through it. If you have doubts, let me know. So I'm going to solve this. I'll erase it. I need some space to solve. So here,
How do I solve 100 factorial? I'll solve all of them separately. So I don't worry about this 2 to the power 25. That doesn't matter because I'm looking at highest exponent of 3. So anyway, 2 is a prime and it does not affect my solution. So don't care about it. Only solve for this part. Now, when I'm solving this part, right? So let us have a look at it. So 100 factorial will be giving you how many, what is the exponent of 3 in that? It's going to be 100 by 3 plus 100 by 3 square plus 100 by 3 power 3 plus 100 by 3 power 4. 100 by 3 power 5 I won't write because 100 by 243 is 0 anyway. GIF of it. I mean greatest integer function of it. Okay, that will be 0. So what is this going to be? This is going to be 33 plus 11 plus 3 plus 1, which is equal to 48. So the exponent of 3 in 100 factorial is 48. Now that is not all. I have to do for 25, I have to do for 50 also. So for 25, it's going to be how much? It's going to be 25 by 3 plus 25 by 9. That's it. Because 25 by 27 will be again 0. So this will be giving me how much? This will be 8 plus 2, which is equal to 10. 8 plus 2, which will be 10. Now 50 factorial. 50 factorial will be how much? 50 by 3 plus 50 by 9 plus 50 by 27. I don't write after that because it will be 0. So that will be how much? 16 plus 5, 21. 21 plus 1, which is 22. That's it. Done. I've got everything. So what is the power here? The power here is 48. Power here is 10 and both are multiplied, right? So powers will get added up, divided by 50 multiplied again. So it will be 22 two times, 22 plus 22, which will be 44. And when I divide, it means powers are subtracted, is it not? So 48 plus 10 minus 44, which will be 14. That is my answer. So why did I do that, guys? I hope all of you got it. 125 factorial multiplied. So exponent of 3 will get added, divided by exponent of 3, 50 into 50 will be added. Since it's divided by, the entire power will get subtracted. 48 plus 10 minus 44. That will be 14. 14 is 2k. So k is equal to how much? K is equal to 7. That will be my answer. Clear? So I hope all of you like this question. If you have any questions, do let me know. If there's any alternative way also for any of these questions, do let me know in the chat or in the comment box below. Okay. So, guys, I hope all of you have got it. I will give you one homework question. And with that, we will conclude our session today. So the answer for this is 7. Again, I hope all of you can see that. Now, the homework question is right over here. All of you can have a look at it. If you have any doubts in the question, I can read it out for you. If n is the number of ways in which 15 identical blankets can be distributed among 6 beggars such that everyone gets at least one blanket and 2 particular beggars get equal blankets and another 3 particular beggars get equal blankets, then the value of n by 2 is how much? Okay, that's the question. And I will be discussing this in the Friday's class, okay? Because many times I forget to answer in the comment, but it's better I do it in Friday's class, so do wait for it, okay? All of you can try it out. I'm probably going to skip the next slide very fast because it has the solution. Okay. I hope I switched very fast. Okay, so guys, thank you for attending this class. I hope all of you learned something good today and see you all in the next one. Take care. Keep working hard. It's just going to be 1 or 1.5 weeks more. So put in your best effort and I hope all of you make it into your dream college. Okay. Take care. Bye-bye, guys. See you.